Hello guys, welcome to another chapter of the Amber Room. Chapter 12, Bolari, Czech Republic, Friday, May 9th, 2:45 p.m. Suzanne angled the Porsche hard to the right, and the 911 Speedster's coil spring suspension and torque steering grabbed the tight curve. She had earlier hinged the glass fiber hood back, allowing the afternoon air to whip her layered bob. She kept the car parked at the Rusyn's airport, the 120 kilometers from Prague to southwestern Bohemia, an easy hour's drive. The car was a gift from Lauren, a bonus 2 years ago after a particularly productive year of acquisitions. Metallic slate grey, black leather interior, plush velvet carpet. Only 150 of the model were produced. Hers bore a gold insignia on the dash. Draha. Little Darling. The nickname Lauren bestowed upon her in childhood. She had heard the tales and read the press on Ernst Lauren. Most portrayed him as baleful, stern, and dismissive, with the energy of a zealot and the morals of a despot. Not far from the mark, but there was another side of him, the one she knew, loved, and respected. Lauren's state occupied a 300-acre tract in southwestern Czech, only kilometers from the German border. The family had flourished under communist rule, their factories and mines in Chomutov, Mostan, Teplice, vital to the old Czechoslovakia's once supposed self-sufficiency. She had always thought it amusing that the family uranium mines north in Jakimov, manned with political prisoners, the worker death toll was nearly 100%, were officially considered irrelevant by the new government. It was likewise unimportant that, after years of acid rain, the sad mountains had been transformed into eerie graveyards of rotting forests. A mere footnote that the place, once a thriving spa town near the Polish border, was renowned more for the short life expectancy of its inhabitants than for its refreshing warm water. She had long ago noticed that no photos of the region were contained in the fancy picture books vendors hawk outside Prague Castle to the millions who visited each year. Northern Czech was a blight, a reminder. Once a necessity, now something to be forgotten. But it was a place where Ernst Lauren profited, and the reason why he lived in the south. The Velvet Resolution of 1989 assured the demise of the communists. 3 years later, Czech and Slovakia divorced, hastily dividing the country's spoils. Lauren benefited from both events, quickly aligning himself with Havel and the new government of the Czech Republic, a name he thought dignified but lacking in punch. She had heard his views about the changes, how his factories and foundries were in demand more than ever. Though spawning communism, Lauren was a tried and true capitalist. His father, Joseph, and his grandfather before had all been capitalists. What did he say all of the time? All political movements need steel and coal. Lauren supplied both, in return for protection, freedom, and a more than modest return on investment. The manor suddenly loomed on the horizon. Castle Lukov, a former knight's hut, the site of a more formidable headland overshadowing the swift Orlik stream. Built in the Burgundian Cistercian style, its earliest construction began in the 15th century, but it wasn't finished until the mid-17th century. Triple Sedilia and leaf capitals lined the towering walls. Oriels dotted vine-covered ramparts, a clay roof flashed orange in the midday sun. A fire ravaged the entire complex during World War II, the Nazis confiscating it as a local headquarters, and the Allies finally bombing it. But Joseph Lauren wrestled back title, allying himself with the Russians, who liberated the area on their way to Berlin. After the war, the elder Lauren resurrected his industrial empire and expanded, ultimately bequeathing everything to Ernst, his only surviving child. a move the government wholly supported. Clever, industrious men were always in demand, her employer had said many times. She downshifted the Porsche to third, the engine groaned, then forced the tires to grab dry pavement. She twisted up the narrow road, the black asphalt surrounded by thick forest, and slowed at the castle's main gate. What once accommodated horse-drawn carriages and deterred aggressors had been widened and paved to easily accept cars. Lerin stood outside in the country yard. Desert, dressed casually, wearing work gloves, apparently tending his spring flowers. He was tall and angular, with a surprisingly flat chest and a strong physique, for a man in his late 70s. Over the past decade, she had watched the silken, ash-blonde hair fade to the point of a lackluster grey, a matching goatee carpeting his crisp jaw and wrinkled neck. Gardening had always been one of his obsessions. The greenhouses outside the walls were packed with exotic plants from around the world. Dobry den, my dear, Lorin called out in Czech. She parked and exited the Porsche, grabbing her travel back out of the passenger seat. Lorin clapped her from his gloves and walked over. Good hunting, I hope. She withdrew a small car box from the passenger seat. Neither costumes in London or Prague questioned the trinket after she explained that it had been bought at a Westminster Abbey gift shop for less than £30. She was even able to reproduce a receipt, since she had stopped by that very shop on the way to the airport, and bought a cheap reproduction, one she trashed at the airport. Lorin jerked off his gloves and lifted the lid, studying the snuff box in the graying afternoon. Beautiful, he whispered. Perfect. She reached back into her bag and extracted the book. What is this? He asked. A surprise. He returned the gold treasure to the cardboard box, then gingerly cradled the volume, unfolding the front cover, marveling at the bookplate. Draha, you amaze me. What a wonderful bonus. I recognized it instantly and thought you had liked it. We can certainly sell or trade this. Herr Greimer loves it, and I would very much like a painting he possesses. I knew you had be happy. This should make Christian take notice, huh? Quite an unveiling at our next gathering. And Franz Fellner. He shook his head. Not anymore. I believe now it's Monica. She seems to be taking over everything. Slowly but surely. Arrogant bitch. True. But she is also no fool. I spoke to her at length recently. A bit impatient and eager. Seems to have inherited her father's spirit, if not his brains. But who knows? She is young. Maybe she will learn. I'm sure Franz will teach her. And what of my benefactor? Any similar thoughts of retirement? Lorin grimed. What would I do? She gestured to the blossoms. Garden? Hardly. What we do is so invigorating. Collecting carries such thrills. I am as a child at Christmas opening packages. Gathered his two treasures and led her inside his woodworking shop, which consumed the ground floor of a building adjacent to the courtyard. I received a call from St. Petersburg, he told her. Christian was in the depository again, in the commission records. Fellner obviously is not giving up. Fine anything? Hard to say. The idiot clerk should have gone through the boxes by now, but I doubt he has. Says it will take years. He seems far more interested in getting paid than working, but he was able to see that Noel discovered a reference to Carol Boria. She realized the significance. I don't understand this obsession of France, Lorin said. So many things waiting to be found. Bellini's Madonna and Child, gone since the war. What a fun that would be. Wenig's altarpiece of the mystical lamp, the 12-volt master stolen from the Treves Museum in 1968, and those impressionist works stolen in Florence. There are not even any photos of those for identification purposes. Anyone would love to acquire just one of them. But the Amber Room is at the top of everyone's collection list, she said. Quite right, and that seems to be the problem. You think Christian will try to find Boria? Without a doubt. Boria and Chapev are the only two searchers left alive. Noel never found Chapeth 5 years ago. He's probably hoping Boria knows Chapeth's whereabouts. Fellner will love the Amber Room to be Monica's first unveiling. There is no doubt in my mind that France will send Noel to America, at least to try to find Boria. But shouldn't that be a dead end? Exactly, literally, but only if necessary. Let's hope Boria has still a tight lip. Maybe the old man finally died. He has to be approaching 90. Go to Georgia, but stay out of the way unless forced to act. A thrill ran through her. How wonderful to battle Noel again. Their last encounter in France had been invigorating. The sex afterwards memorable. He was a worthy opponent, but dangerous, which made the adventure that much more exciting. Careful with Christian, my dear. Not too close. You may have to do some unpleasant things. Leave him to Monica. They deserve one another. She pecked the old man on the cheek with a soft kiss. Not to worry. Your dragon will not let you down.